Hi, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on where you are. I'd like to welcome you to our webinar today. My name is Jenny Williams. I'm the Director of Product Marketing here at Forth. Thank you for joining us on for our webinar on effectively managing multi-unit operations using technology. I'd like to start with a few housekeeping items. The webinar is going to be recorded. You will receive an email with the link to the recording right after the webinar ends. So feel free to share that recording with your colleagues, review it however you'd like. And please feel free to ask questions during the presentation. We're going to try to answer as many of them as we can throughout the presentation. And you don't have to wait until the end, although we will do some Q&A at the end as well. There's a question panel over on the right hand of your screen. You can just submit those questions and I'll be watching for them and helping to facilitate getting those questions answered. And then also you'll probably be seeing a button to register if you'd like. There is an in-depth demo as a follow-up to today's presentation being hosted by Dylan Wattekamp tomorrow. Feel free to sign up for that if you want to see some of the things that we're talking about today in action. With that, I'm going to go ahead and introduce our speakers today. With us today, we have Jay Altizer, who's our Chief Operating Officer here at Forth, and we also have Hannah Heighton, the VP of Product Strategy. And with that, I'm going to hand it off to them to Jay and let him kick us off.
Well, thank you, Jenny, and welcome everyone. I'm joining you from the very sunny and unusually warm UK today. So let's set ourselves up for the rest of the half hour. So our focus for today is going to be talking about the evolving challenges of multi-unit operations and the challenges that our customers are sharing with us that they're dealing with in chains. So what we're going to do is I'll talk a little bit about what we're hearing from our customers and the feedback that we're getting in terms of those challenges and how customers are addressing and solving them. Then we'd actually like to hear from you. We'll do a couple of polls to see how the year is playing out and if those views we have on the marketplace still hold true. Then we'll spend most of our time with Hannah talking about ways that we believe technology can help both unit managers, the managers that are in stores, and also area managers, the leaders in your organizations that are responsible for multiple units. When we get through that, we'll have some time for Q&A, and we will answer your questions as best we can and try to set up the demo. So that is our agenda for the day. Just a quick reminder about Forth, who we are and what we do. So we, Forth, are a SaaS technology provider in restaurant and hospitality. So we provide solutions for human capital management and workforce management, notably the Hot Schedules app some of you may have heard of, or the PeopleMatter software for hiring and applicant tracking. We do inventory management. Our Macromatics product would be an example of that. And then we have analytics tools and intelligence tools that both help forecast and plan restaurant operations and hospitality operations and also analyze and benchmark across your operations so that you can steer within those other areas and parameters. So that's what we do, and we hope that gives us some perspective on what's going on in chain operations these days. Let me talk for a moment about what we're hearing from our customers. So we convene a customer advisory board a couple of times per year, and we got together in February to talk about what our customers or the advisory board customers were seeing in their operations. And a question we asked them were, what are your top three strategic goals that you can see represented here as Word Cloud? And as you can see, there's a lot of focus on growth, whether that's expansion through new units or whether that's driving growth through existing stores, same store sales growth. Another theme that we hear, you'll see a lot of words in here that have to do with profit. So a lot of talk and a lot of focus, not just on sales growth, but profitable growth, which the sense we have is that that's been elusive. Growing profitably has been elusive, even though top lines are up, because there's been quite a bit of cost pressure, both on the food line and also on the labor line and restaurant P&Ls. Third thing we're seeing is that many of these operators, chain operators, are focused on talent in a variety of ways: talent attraction, talent retention, developing unit managers, compliance with labor laws, and a theme we hear is that as much now as ever, talent, and particularly talent at the manager level, is a really important component of achieving profitable growth. And so I'm going to ask for some feedback in a minute to see if we're still seeing the world that way. So another topic that we discussed with this group of operators were, what challenges are you seeing or experiencing in achieving those goals? Again, represented here as a word cloud. And I want to talk about three or four of them. Obviously, centered here in the screen is inflation and wage inflation, cost of goods, food inflation of both. Had a significant input on restaurant margins, and there's a lot of conversation right now about can we still continue to deal with that in pricing, or do we need to look elsewhere in the P&L to recover our margins? Second topic that we talked about as a challenge, which you see here in it's sort of spread around in some of these different words, is talent. So developing talent is and improving talent is a strategic goal, but it's also a challenge with retention difficult, with manager turnover proving challenging, with compliance and pay issues, et cetera. And then a third challenge, interestingly, is technology and how well technology either does or doesn't help with some of these other issues, and how well technology sort of does or doesn't help unit operators achieve those goals.
Jay, I did actually I saw a question come through. So when your customers answered that technology was a challenge to growth, did you have some specific examples of that?
Yes, and the I'm going to move back to that page so the poll doesn't come up. This would be it would be cases where either it's the technology's difficult for managers to use, or that you've got legacy solutions that aren't taking work off of the managers, or you've just got you've got processes inherent in technology that are just hard to use. So the role of technology is really interrelated with who unit managers are and what the job is. And I think to the customers we have that have better functioning systems that are easier for managers to use with sort of common sense processes, have better outcomes than when they're clunkier processes that just make the manager's day harder. If that's an answer to that. Anything else question wise, Jenny? And if not, I'd kind of like to go to the poll.
I think we can go on to the poll.
Let's do it. So, going back to the thoughts on challenges that you're seeing this year, I'd love for everybody to respond and pick top three challenges which remain the most pressing, or top three challenges. Going back to that first list of issues that you're seeing, and you can vote, and then I think we can all see the results in. We can all see the results over to the side. All right, and it looks like we've still got some votes coming in. Talent retention at the manager level. I want to talk about that some more. Talent attraction, food costs. So it looks like food inflation and talent sort of remain at the top of the list. So continuing on this theme, here were the top activities that our customers talked about getting assistance with, or having technology help managers. So front and center is scheduling labor, getting stores staffed optimally so that you're both managing what your labor costs and not missing out on sales because you don't have your operations staff to deal with peaks. Ordering, getting food in the door, and we hear a lot of conversation that's also around optimization. So it's, yes, I need to make sure that I've got food ready to prepare, but I don't want to overorder, but I don't want to miss peak demand periods. Both of which are tied into forecasting. So how do I forecast and plan my weeks? How do I head into the week with a good notion of what's going to happen, so that I can prepare, so that if things deviate from my plan, I can adapt. So scheduling, ordering, forecasting, and then I'm going to put inventory, which also shows up here as a large item in the same bucket with ordering. All right.
I did see another question come in on that last slide, Jay. So inventory looked kind of large on this page. What specifically about inventory was most important to automate?
Yeah. So I can answer that one. So it's really mostly around purchasing and then the production and prep lists. So for example, anecdotally, one of our CAP participants who uses our labor but not our inventory was saying that his managers are spending 2 hours each time they put in a purchase order, and they're doing that three times a week. And same with production. So they're spending a bunch of time putting out these production and prep lists, but they're actually static and they're not updating in real time, which is something that, again, the manager has to continue to oversee, and it takes a lot of time. So basically bringing in data to streamline and automate the inventory processes around purchasing and production, and go back to save the manager time. Let's focus on the things that matter most to guests is kind of the number one thing for inventory.
Great, thank you.
All right, let's do one more poll here. So similar to the last question, let's choose top three. Which activities do you think technology can most help your managers with? Or which activities would you like technology to most help your unit managers with? And let's go to the poll. All right, it looks like scheduling, purchasing and receiving inventory, hiring employees, automating the hiring process. This one's more hotly contested than the last poll. So scheduling, hiring, purchasing, training new employees, compliance and scheduling, that's certainly something that we hear. There's a lot of complexity to that to the extent you can help managers with that, that is a benefit. Okay, that's great. So many of these same tasks, we think it can and should be helped by technology. Look, and maybe just to put a bow on what we've been talking about so far, or share sort of a summary thought. One way that we look at how to make multi-unit operations effective is to make managers effective at making good decisions and really having technology take unnecessary work off of managers while also getting data in the hands of above store managers in a way that lets them guide, engage, coach, so that you're ideally both the unit manager and the above store manager are out of the weeds and can focus on higher value activities and higher order conversations. So to talk about how we do that or our views on that, Hannah is going to share four ways that we think technology can help.
Thank you, Jay. And thank you for all of those that responded to the polls. So I'm now going to talk to you about how our solutions, specifically four of them, can again de-stress your manager, kind of take the weight off of their shoulders. So we will follow this same structure on the pages going forward. So I'll very high level tell you what the capabilities of this certain solution is. And then on the right hand side, I'll tell you the business outcomes that our customers who are using them have been able to achieve. So I'm going to start with automated scheduling and our compliance rules engine, since that was kind of the number one topic we need technology to help us with. So in terms of the capabilities, it really all starts with your forecast. This is the foundation of everything, as we all know. At Forth, we're continuously improving the accuracy of our forecasts. We've recently invested in a team of data science experts to launch a new AI-driven forecast, which is showing great success so far, an improvement of up to 25% accuracy in some cases. So this is something we're really excited about. Next, we put an auto scheduler on top of that. So this is kind of how we work with you during that process. We essentially have dedicated labor's rules consultants that will work with your above store leaders to define what labor rules work best for your unique business goals, because everyone will be very different. You know, our services are based upon years of implementing auto scheduling at top enterprise customers, monitoring the results, and of course, improving those rules to inform best practices going forward. After we've kind of done that at the above store level, we'll also build in compliance rules. So we know, especially if you're in a Fair Work Week state, this is a very hot topic of discussion, but we'll also have a rules configuration there where you can put in things like right to rest or breaks, et cetera. Once that's done at the above store level, what I love about it is when you bring it to the daily life of the manager, it's really just a click of the button to schedule your shifts. So you're not only saving the manager time, but because there is a wide variance in a more tenured manager versus a less tenured manager, if they're using the auto scheduler, it stays very consistent in the results and the outcomes that they're able to schedule off of. Then once you kind of got that schedule done, we know it doesn't end there. We've also automated employee request to changes like shift releases and shift swaps once that schedule is locked. So now the results.
Hey, Hannah. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. We had a question come through. I thought you were paused. Want to know what types of labor rules you can put into the auto scheduler. Is there a wide variety? Can you customize them?
There is a wide variety. And again, you can use which ones you want and you cannot use the ones you don't want. Dylan can tell you more later, but just to list a couple off the top of my head, it starts very simple with X people for X driver. You could then put max and min people. You can take in time off requests and availability requests from your employees. You can put in break stacking rules, skills. I love this one. So skills is interesting where you can say, okay, don't put all my newest people on the same shift at the same time, but also don't put all my tenured people on the same shift at the same time because they could be more expensive. So I like that skills one. And then of course, like some of the compliance stuff you can also fit in. But again, it's really up to your kind of wants and needs on which you use.
Awesome, thank you.
Okay, so now before I talk through the results, I did want to mention this is based upon a sample of 30 customers that reported before and after metrics pre using this solution and then post using the solution. So we were able to save on average about 4 hours per week in manager time. Guest satisfaction increases about 2.5% on average. Sales 0.7%, and then labor costs is split into two, about 3.5% savings on regular pay. And then on top of that, 2.5% savings on penalty pay, which is what we classify as overtime and then any fair work week breaches that incur penalty pay. So pretty good outcomes. Let's move to the next page where we actually talk about a single case study to really bring this all to life. Okay, so what I love about this case study is it's not just about reducing labor, but optimizing it. So what they actually did was they invested more labor during peak hours and then made up for that by pulling people when the demand forecast was lower, mostly around opening and close. Because they were able to get more people in the times when it really mattered, they raised guest satisfaction rates by 2.4% between pilot and non-pilot stores. At the same time, which is kind of more the cherry on top, because they divested in labor kind of around opening and close, they saved $1 million company-wide on their whole system, which is about 300 units. So really just shows that it's not all about just cost reduction, but using optimized labor to drive better guest experience, which ultimately drives profitable growth, which is something that Jay touched on. Okay. One last case study on labor. Want to talk through time savings. How did we get to that 4 hours? So most of it is actually through shift releases and shift swaps. So the scheduling is one piece, but once that schedule is set, sometimes your employees need to make changes, et cetera. This is actually a full service restaurant with about 100 employees in store and about 600 units across the United States. We worked with them to uncover that they were doing 861 shift releases and 64 shift swaps per location per month. Using our technology, we're basically able to shave off about 4.5 minutes for each of those transactions and give the manager back 16 hours weekly per location. So that is literally 2 days of work saved from the managers at these stores, which is amazing. And especially thinking of all the more value-add activities they could be doing with those 16 hours. Any questions on these two? Okay. So let's move on to inventory. So it's not all about labor. A lot of the challenges you all are experiencing are related to inventory also. And we can drive similar time and food cost savings with our inventory platform for multi-chain operators, which is called Macromatics. So starting with the capabilities first, foundation again is the AI forecast. Again, what I love about this AI forecast is it's the same forecast, right? So your managers are not going over here for labor, tinkering with a forecast, not going over here for inventory. It is all connected and all integrated. So based on that forecast, we then can submit a purchase order based upon, you know, your current stock levels, your expected deliveries, par levels, etc. We can easily handle returns big challenge we're hearing is that a lot of suppliers are sending damaged items, wrong items, et cetera. So everything around credit memos, receival of goods, that's handled in our solution. And then we also go to production and prep. So this is one of our newest features. It's something that our current customers are really loving, and we're getting a lot of adoption. But essentially, we use the forecast to set a production schedule. Then we feed in our real-time sales in 15-minute increments to update the production and prep. So for example, if you're a chicken QSR and, big family comes in, orders like 10 buckets of chicken, you may run out quicker than the production schedule said, then it would ramp up so that you hit your same speed of services for your next customers. So it improves not only speed of service, but also like food quality, food waste, things like that. So what does that mean in terms of results? So time saved is about 8 hours, purchasing, counting, managing cash, and about 2% food costs, mainly through the purchasing waste. So kind of when things expire, but also we're now starting to see some production waste being saved. Okay. Last. So we talked a lot about the unit manager, but what if you install all this great technology and you're still not seeing results, or maybe some managers are doing better than others? Like, how can you observe that? How can you get the right data into the hands of the area managers so that they know where to coach? So that is through our fourth analytics platform. So if you have labor and you have inventory in store, this kind of sits above for your area manager, kind of above store leaders. So how this works is we work with you to set up custom dashboards with the KPIs that matter most. So you can pick what it looks like, what's in there, et cetera. You're also able to choose hierarchies. So you can see it at different hierarchies, rather whether it's the area or maybe by location, that's all in there. And then my most favorite part about this is that it easily depicts variances and coaching opportunities for your area managers. So if you look on the right side, you can see that, for example, like Indianapolis is ranked number 2 overall across a variety of metrics, but they actually are ranked 15th in sales and guests. So we may need to get in there and understand like what's driving lower guest satisfaction for that certain restaurant. So always kind of trying to improve, trying to give the data the area managers need specifically to manage these multi-unit operations, given they can't be everywhere at once. Okay. Any questions? All right. So that is really it in terms of the four solutions we think are kind of most optimal to run your multi-unit restaurants and also to save your manager time while also optimizing business outcomes. So as a summary, it's labor, it's inventory, saving 4 to 8 hours a week, 2% food costs, 3.5% in labor costs, all with the ability to give managers back time so they can focus on your guests and growing profitably. I will wrap there, and I think we will now move on to a Q&A session.
That's right. And let me just also mention, as we're moving into Q&A, at some point, I think we want to have Dylan talk about that upcoming webinar and set that up. Jenny, you want to do that now and just talk about that real quick?
Yeah. So, as I mentioned at the in opening, for anyone who may have missed it, I think you may have even seen the fourth bot pop up a button there if you want to register. We are having a follow-up webinar tomorrow to do an in-depth demo around our labor optimization and how you can get some, use some insights from your data in order to, improve your overall labor scheduling. And, save your manager's time. So Dylan will be doing that tomorrow. So look for the fourth bot to pop up the registration if you haven't already registered and you want to see a little bit more of a demo there. All right. And with that, if you have questions for anyone on our panel, please feel free to put those into the question box. And I will kind of field those out as they come in. There you go. And there's that fourth bot demo. So you can click save your spot and go ahead and register if you'd like to join us tomorrow. And if you can't join tomorrow, you can go ahead and register anyway, and it'll be recorded and you'll be able to watch it at your own leisure. All right, great. And with that, it looks like I've got a few questions starting to come in. All right, so the first question is, while an AI-driven forecast sounds great, can we control our schedule so that manager, sorry, I misread that. Can we still control our schedule so that to align with what managers feel is best for the week?
Oh, sure. Yeah, the forecast, the idea of AI forecasting is to get a first shot at the forecast that's highly accurate. But of course, managers are going to have local knowledge and understand, I mean, think about high school football or, you know, local events, construction there. Managers are going to understand local operating conditions, and we make it so that they can override that and make changes to the forecast. But the idea of the AI is to get it, you know, in the ballpark, and hopefully to the point that managers don't have to make a lot of modifications. But it's not, we're not taking that ability away.
Yeah, and we're also, we force a reason for a manager adjustment. So if you do go to Forth Analytics and you compare forecast accuracy to actuals and you see some managers are lagging, you can then kind of go in and kind of see, why did I adjust? Like when you adjust for local sporting events, you're kind of overshooting, undershooting. So it's kind of another coaching opportunity.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. It looks like another question's come in. How easy is it to set up those custom dashboards? Can it integrate with my other reporting tools?
It's pretty easy. Again, it's very similar to the auto scheduler in that we have a consultative expert to help you do it. It integrates, of course, with all of our platforms, and it can also take in third-party data. I think a lot we see popular is like NPS, some Yelp reviews. People like to go in there. We don't quite recommend integrating with other reporting tools because this does seem to be like the single source of truth, and that's kind of the point of it. But you know, every case is different, and we can make that happen too.
All right. Would dynamic production work for restaurants with more complex menus, or is it just for QSRs?
Yes. So dynamic production typically works best for QSR, given that they pre-cook, right? But for prep, it's also very useful for FSRs. So if you're cooking to order, but you're making a burger and the burger has lettuce on it and you don't have any lettuce prepped, that's a problem. And that impacts speed of quantity. So I would do production for QSRs and then prep more for FSR.
And it looks like I've got one more popped in. I'm struggling with compliance rules that vary across locations. Can hot schedules help with that?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Jay, do you want to take that one?
No. Affirmatively, yes. But why don't you talk to me?
Yes, affirmatively, yes, I agree. We have rules configurations where basically you can choose certain rules you want and then group them as like New York Fair Work Week, Oregon Fair Work Week, general like underage rules or something like that. And then you can apply each of those sets to any different location. So different rules for New York versus Oregon if you have locations in both. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Looks like all the questions we have for today. I don't see any more in the question box. If anybody would like to, if you do have further questions that weren't answered here today that you want to ask on an individual basis, you can reach out directly to Jay or Hannah. I've included their contact information here. And also, please, you know, do join us tomorrow for the in-depth demo of the labor solutions that we featured today. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and close out the webinar. As I mentioned before, you will get an email with a link so that you can rewatch the recording, share it with your colleagues, with any downline managers you may have that you think can benefit from this. And we appreciate y'all joining us today.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye. Thank you.